Next talk will be on genetic diversity by Shyam Prabhakar.
Thanks, Ed, and thanks to the organizers. I'm here representing multiple groups studying genetic diversity in the HCA. And first, I should say that when I say genetic diversity, it's just a shorthand to save breath, but actually we're talking about genetic diversity, geographical diversity, sex, lifestyle, environment, everything. Okay, it's all relevant. So recently, CZI funded a bunch of seed networks studying genetic diversity, and some of them are over here. Immune, multiple tissues, brain, adipose, breast, and many of these, you heard about the SCEQTL-GEN consortium yesterday from Monique. So many of these teams are already in SCEQTL-GEN, and there's even more within that consortium. So why is there all this activity, right? Why do we care so much about all of these forms of diversity, and why are people funding it so much? So take a look at this. One goal of the Human Cell Atlas is to build a healthy reference so that we can understand disease better. Okay, so what do we know about disease and diversity? So this is quite a scary figure when I was shown it by my colleague, John Chambers. I think it was John Chambers who showed it to me a long time ago. So if you look at diversity over here in risk of coronary artery disease as a function of your total cholesterol, you can see that, yeah, as your cholesterol intake goes up, your risk of heart disease goes up. We kind of know that, and so you want to reduce your cholesterol intake for sure. But also, as you become more Asian Indian, your risk of heart disease goes up, and you can't reduce your Asian Indian-ness, you know. So that's close to home for me. So, there's a tenfold difference over here in heart disease risk. It's, you know, this affects you much more than, say, your cholesterol intake, right? Now, this is not necessarily genetic. It's some combination of genetics and your lifestyle and environment, and that's what people have been trying to study for a long time since we discovered things like this in epidemiology. So clearly, diversity is important, and people's disease susceptibility is influenced by, you know, presumably who you are, where you come from, and so on. Here are some other examples from Sarah Tishkoff, who's also leading one of these seed networks. So risk of hypertension, risk of diabetes, varies quite a bit by population group. So this is probably some combination of genetics and environment. We don't know what's contributing how much. Right? So an important topic. And how do we address it? So I mentioned genetics and environment. So here's a NOMAD human genetics variation database by population group. And you can see here that Europeans, and again, I won't get into who's a European, but Europeans as a population group are overrepresented in this database, and many other population groups are underrepresented. So this is genetics, and this is gene expression, which is influenced by genetics and environment. Even in the GTEx database, Europeans are overrepresented, and other populations are underrepresented. So clearly, we're not getting a comprehensive picture on how all of these factors vary, or these disease risk factors vary across population, what the molecular mechanisms are potentially, and so on. And that's really the motivation for all of our work. So to summarize, lack of diversity in human genomics and epigenomics and epidemiology research, it impedes our ability to understand, again, this is from Sarah, the genetic architecture and epigenetic architecture of human disease, and exacerbates health inequalities, because all of your interventions, all of your diagnostics will be based on a biased molecular knowledge, and impedes translating research into clinical practice as a result. So you can make disastrous mistakes if you say, aha, I found a mutation in this person, I found a gene expression trait in this person. It's way outside the norm, so this must be have some diagnostic value and must be actionable. But actually, what is the norm? What's way outside the norm for one population group may be the norm for a different population group, and that's well studied now. And that's what I was referring to earlier, inaccurate assessment of pathogenic variants, and also not just genetic variants, but other molecular diagnostics. So we really need to remedy this, right? And so here's what Sarah's doing in sub-Saharan Africa. doing single-cell analysis on diverse population groups from, I think, two different major language families in sub-Saharan Africa. And it's a very nice comprehensive study that she's initiated. Look at single-cell RNA-seq, single-cell ATAC-seq in a very large number of ethnically diverse Africans, and then look at variation within an individual, within a population, across populations, and actually do immune in vitro immune stimulation and see how even that varies, how those molecular traits vary across individuals. And then say, what are the genomic and epigenomic traits or features that contribute to these differences? So this is a fairly broad template for this kind of single-cell study. And Jimmy at UCSF is another leading another seed network, again for immune. And I should note he's a pioneer of MuckSeq, which is a very important methodology for doing this kind of large-scale single-cell RNA-seq. And what MuckSeq does, I'll come to that in a minute. But Jimmy's looking at, again, population diversity, this time in the US, but many, many different population groups, large number of samples, genotyping as well, and Sarah's also genotyping. Everyone has to genotype in addition to doing single-cell RNA-seq. And he's also looking at diurnal cycles and seasonal cycles, menstrual cycles, from a smaller number of individuals but sampled at various points, to say how does normal vary even in the same individual but across time. And all of our studies are powered by this technique that Jimmy and others have developed called MuckSeq, whereas basically you mix samples from multiple individuals and process them simultaneously for single-cell analysis, and then later on you bioinformatically demultiplex them because you've genotyped them. So you say these reads, this cell has this genotype, must have come from that individual, right? So it's a very elegant method, and it helps you scale up, save costs, reduce batch effects, and so on. So and that's the cost saving. It's quite dramatic. And so any large epidemiological single-cell study will really benefit from this method if you can practically use it. So what are we doing in Asia? Well, I'll reprise this figure about GTEx, and you see here that there's only 1.1% Asians in GTEx, and I don't even know what fraction of those are Asian Indians that have these very much higher CAD risk. Not just that, these Asians, I presume, were sampled in the West, and so they may not be representative of the diversity of Asians all over the world. They may be non-representative. So we really need to address that. And that was the impetus for the Asian Immune Diversity Atlas, AIDA, which has similar goals to the other immune seed networks. We're also doing RNA ATAC-seq, genotyping, algorithm development, BCR-TCR profiling, and so on, and population group sex environment. I'll say a little bit more about that. So some of the AIDA team members are here if you want to learn more, not just me, but Wong Yang is in the audience and Jay Shin also. So what is AIDA doing? With three initial populations, so Japanese, Korean, and then in Singapore being a multi-ethnic country, you have Malay, Indian, Chinese profiled side by side in the same lab with the same collection. And as an external control, we'll include European samples as well. Same European samples profiled in all three countries to look for site-specific effects. And to look at environmental differences, we'll say, the Indians in Singapore are can be compared to Indian samples from India to say roughly same genetic gene pool, different environment. How does that affect us? And again, as I mentioned, we're aligning our methodology with Jimmy and Sarah and multiple other people doing this kind of work. So I talked about the data generation. The data analysis gets a short shrift very often in such discussions. So I just want to say, once you generate all this data, you need to robustly reduce batch effects and say which cell type is this cell, and then you need to do your downstream analysis. But without knowing the phenotype or the type of a cell, you can't go forward very much. So we have an algorithm I'll put in a plug for called RCA, reference-based annotation of cell types, not annotation, but clustering of cell types. Here you see each column is a cell, each row is a reference transcriptome, and you can see here the cells cluster very cleanly, even the rare cell types, by their reference transcriptome. So it's an easier thing to do, to cluster by reference, than to cluster de novo when you don't know anything in advance. And when the, as the human cell atlas defines all cell types in the human body, defines their reference transcriptomes, these reference-guided methods for clustering cells will become more and more powerful. Right now, we have a fairly limited reference. Another thing that's often ignored is feature selection. Which genes do you use to study your data sets? Because you know, you're clustering cells together by the transcriptome, but not all of the genes in the transcriptome are relevant. So we have an algorithm that's not published yet, Dubstepper, which does feature selection. Each row is a gene, each column is a gene here, and this is a gene-gene correlation matrix, and you heard a lot about gene-gene correlations yesterday. We use that too. We regress out genes that explain a lot of variance in the gene-gene correlation matrix until finally there's not much variance left in the gene-gene correlation matrix, and that's our and then some downstream product of that is our feature set. So how does Dubstepper do? As a principle, we do a lot of benchmarking of all our algorithms against existing methods because there are already other feature selection methods out there. So the x-axis is how many genes you use to cluster your cells, and y-axis is some measure of how well you do in clustering your cells, and this is average over 9 benchmark data sets. You see that for mostly, it doesn't matter how many feature genes you select, Dubstepper is quite robust in giving you accurate clustering. This is just a vignette, and also, it tends to be, on average, the top-ranked algorithm for any individual data set. So, and again, this is just a short part of it. There's a lot more we need to do for algorithm development, a lot more we need to do for genetic population diversity, lifestyle diversity, and so on. So we need to cover all of these features, all of these factors in health, physiology, disease, risk. That's a major goal of the Human Cell Atlas Equity Group. And we just started this, I would say. We need new methodology for data analysis, for integrating data across all of these different sites, because inevitably you'll have data from different countries to make a more powerful analysis. But then how do you get rid of those site-specific effects? Also, do you classify cells by discrete type? Or do you say when you have variation in a healthy population, you have a continuum of variation? If so, how do you define the genetics of a continuum of variation in cell state? So all challenging questions, and again, there's a lot of work to do. So thank you to everyone who has funded any of these projects, and thank you for anyone who's participating, and hope many more can participate in these consortia. Thank you.
This is fantastic. I had a question on the data sharing side. Do you see any challenges with data sharing across HCA of data from indigenous populations? Or, you know, the kid in India and Singapore have different data sharing approaches. So even though both kids are of Indian genetics, they're not. The data is actually not maybe in the same position.
Yeah. Thanks for that. That's a major challenge, and that's why we started this as a pilot project to say, can we address those data sharing issues? It's not just a scientific issue. So getting samples out of a country sometimes is very difficult, or getting data out of a country, it's possible if it's healthy data, sometimes not possible if it's disease data, and so on. So we just have to start down that road and see how do we address all of these challenges in the various countries.
Yeah, so I assumed up front that you actually can get the samples out. If you can get the samples out, what are kind of the pros and cons, you know, having distributed processing of the samples versus shipping them off all off to get processed in the end together?
So again, I think GTEx and some other consortia looking at bulk RNA-seq have addressed this to some extent, and there one of the major conclusions was it's okay to generate data at diverse sites as long as you harmonize your protocols, but we're going to test that again for single cell. We're generating data at diverse sites. We're going to also ship the same samples from the US so that we can look at lab-specific effects, and then we can better answer your question for single-cell data.
Any more questions? All right, thank you again.